your name and DOC number for the record, please.
Michael Carneal, 151127.
Thank you, Mr. Carneal. I am Ms. Jones. My colleague, Mr. Brock, is also on camera. We will be conducting your parole eligibility hearing today. Mr. Carneal, this is your first hearing?
Yes.
All right. Today, sir, we will discuss the crimes of which you're serving your sentence for. We will discuss the circumstances around those crimes, any criminal history that you had prior to those crimes or since being incarcerated. Also, since you have been incarcerated, we will discuss any programs you have completed, programs you're currently enrolled in or on the wait list for, or programs you've been discharged or terminated from. And since this is an opportunity of parole today for you, sir, we will discuss your future plans, such as where you would live, who you would live with, and where you would work. Mr. Carneal, do you understand all of those things, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Carneal, our record reflects you are 39 years old. You're housed there at KSR, medium custody, eligible for parole in November. You are currently serving a life sentence for murder, violent crime, 3 counts, criminal attempt at murder, 5 counts, and burglary first degree. You have served approximately 24 years and 9 months. You have 180 days of meritorious good time loss, no prior paroles, and no pending detainers. Does all of that information sound accurate, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Mr. Carneal, we'll start the hearing with you telling us, how have you prepared for today?
I've had 25 years to prepare for today, and it still doesn't seem like it's happening. I've been talking to my parents a lot about it. I talked to my sister. I recently reconnected with my sister, and I've been having open discussions with her about it. And, you know, I've had a social worker with the DBA that's helped me get everything together. And I've recently enrolled in some a program, and I did that. And, you know, I'm doing the best I can for this parole hearing, putting my best foot forward.
All right, sir, you've had about 25 years to prepare. What does that plan look like?
Well, I plan on living with my parents, and I would like to be independent from them after a couple of years. I realize that there's a lot of things I would have to do to get there, but that would be my plan. And they have said that they would help me get to parole hearing, parole appointments, doctor appointments, anything that I need. I would plan on getting a job. I'm not really particular about what kind of job I would have. I mean, fast food, anything would be suitable for me. You know, I mean, like, I have jobs in here that I've maintained, and sanitation type jobs, and I could do that, you know, for the long term, anything really, as far as employment goes.
I will acknowledge for the record that we have received a few letters of support on your behalf, as well as a plan submitted by your legal counsel. But I think what's most important is that the board would have received a letter or a plan from you. Is there any particular reason that you didn't submit anything to the board?
No, not particularly. I thought everything had been covered in the plan and my parents and my family's letters.
Well, Mr. Carneal, what I'm getting at is that it's important for us to know that you have support on the outside. But what's most important is for you to share with the board why or how you will avoid making the same or similar decision that you made that brought you into the institution. And no plan from anyone else can articulate that better than the person himself.
Yes.
And we did not receive that. And I'm not sure that in 25 years that you've provided us at this point with the real in-depth plan. You're telling us what your parents are going to do. You're telling us what your attorney, your caseworker has submitted. But we need to know, most importantly, what you will do to avoid from making the same decision that you made that brought you into this institution. So I'll give you a moment and see if you can come up with something to share with us.
I think one of the most crucial parts would be maintaining mental health care and counseling. I've learned over the years to accept that help when it's offered, and sometimes I need to seek it out. And I think that'd be very important in this situation. If it were to happen, that I would need to maintain some sort of mental health care, that would be very beneficial to me.
Okay. So in regards to your mental health care, do you have a specific diagnosis?
I've received multiple ones over the years. It's gotten to the situation where I don't really pay attention to that. I just discuss with the doctors what I'm experiencing and what I'm feeling, and what I get back from them is what I listen to. I don't really pay attention to the diagnosis as much, because different doctors have said different things over the years.
Do you believe your mental health played a part in the crimes that you committed?
Yes, I do.
Okay, tell me about that.
Well, I was hearing things, and I was extremely hyper suspicious, and I had felt for years feeling alienated and different. And I think that when I started to develop mental health problems, that it fed into that, and it kind of it made my mental health problems worse, that I had spent those years feeling like that. And it got to the point where I was hearing things in my mind to do certain things, and I was doing them. I wasn't strong enough, or I wasn't thinking properly enough to evaluate what I was being told to do, and I just found myself doing that.
So tell me what you were being told to do, if you can recall.
Oh, different things. I think one of the first things I remember was I had a pistol that I had gotten out of a lockbox in my father's closet, and I had it, and I was looking at it, and I heard in my head shoot myself, and I was holding it to my head, and then I put it in my mouth, and I put it in my head to my head, and I didn't do it for some reason. I don't know why, but that was one instance where I didn't do what I was hearing to do. And to me, that shows that at any point in time, I should have been able to not do what I was hearing to do, because in that instance, I did. So in my mind, I think now, maybe any time that happened, I should have been able to not do it.
Were voices telling you to do something on December the 1st, 1997?
Yes, ma'am.
And what did they tell you to do?
Pick up the gun out of the backpack and hold it in front of me and shoot. There's no justification or excuse for what I did. I'm offering an explanation. I realize that there's no excuse for what I did. I'm just trying to explain it.
So if we fast forward from that day till today, are you still having hearing voices that tell you to do things?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and what kind of things are they telling you to do?
different things. Sometimes it's just like to scream. Sometimes it's something that I would see that would seem silly to me. And most of the time it's things that like hurt myself or something like that. And I know now that that's not something that I should do. And I'm able to not do it and rationalize that it's not something that I should do. And what I'm hearing is not real, but on like a subconscious level, it is something that is inside my mind. This is produced by my mind. And that's troubling to me, that anything that I've heard at any point in my life was part of me. These terrible things is something that came from me.
Mr. Cornell, when was the last time that you heard one of these voices that told you to do something harmful?
A couple of days ago.
And do you recall what that voice told you to do?
Jump off the stairs, jump down the stairs.
All right. Mr. Cornell, if I am recalling the things that you have shared with me this morning as it pertains solely to your mental health, you state that you were having, you were hearing voices prior to December 1st, 1997. On that date, you heard a voice and it told you to commit the crimes that you committed. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And if we fast forward 25 years, just as recent as 2 days ago, you're saying voices are still telling you to do harmful things.
Yes.
Is that correct? Okay. So as the parole board, our number one charge is to maintain public safety. Do you think that in the condition or the state that you are in mentally that contributed to, as you state, the crimes that you committed 25 years ago, do you think the board would be maintaining public safety if we released you on parole today?
I have only one instance of violence in my institutional record, and I'm able now to rationalize what I am thinking and what I'm experiencing. And I have the help of counselors and family and people I can talk to. And it's not something I have acted on in a lot, very long time, decade.
Now, you still have not answered my question. Do you think that it would be in the best interest of the Commonwealth if the parole board gave you an opportunity of parole today, considering the things that you've shared with us today regarding your mental health?
I think I can do a lot of good out there. I think I can benefit the Commonwealth. I think I can benefit people as a whole. So I think.
Is that a yes, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, you've been incarcerated 25 years. I'm sure that you've had lots of opportunities to complete programs. But before we move to that, it's important to note, I know you said that you don't pay attention to your mental health, but it is of your record that even with the medical attention that you've received, that you are still experiencing paranoid thoughts with violent visual imagery. Are you aware of that notation?
No, ma'am.
Are you still having violent visual imagery?
Sometimes, yes.
Okay. All right. We'll move past that. Let's talk about the programs you've completed in the last 25 years.
Oh, you want me to? Okay. When I was in juvenile custody, I completed the the residential program there, and I got to a graduation phase. And I had a setback where I was reduced a level, but then I was able to get the level back to graduation phase. And then when I came to adult corrections, I completed the correctional psychiatric treatment unit program when I got here, and they had different wings. I was in the B wing program, and I completed that. And when I was in juvenile custody, I also got my GED. But then once I got out of the correctional psychiatric treatment unit and came to the general population, I was able to enroll in college classes. And I took some of those for quite a while, and I need just a couple of classes to get an associate's degree, and the program was eliminated. So I wasn't able to finish that. And I've done anger management as well recently.
All right. And with regards to anger management, it looks like when looking over your disciplinary violations, though you have had quite a bit of time of clear conduct, there was a stretch of time where you got into a few fights. Can you explain that?
My cell had been robbed. I thought, well, an officer had let the inmates in to steal some of my stuff. He later admitted to it, the officer did. And I thought that I knew who had done it, and I confronted them instead of letting the officials handle what had happened. I took it upon myself, which I shouldn't have done, to confront these inmates, and fights happened. And I got hit in the head with a hot pot, and it was a bad situation.
And I will note that you have, about 9 years of clear conduct. How have you managed to avoid confrontation in those 9 years?
I mainly keep to myself. I associate with a small amount of people, and I kind of take pride in the fact that I don't get caught up in the what people call prison politics, you know, the drama that goes on amongst different individuals. I don't get involved in it. I kind of, some people say that I'm scared, or whatever the situation may be, I'm scared to join other people. But in all reality, I'm just trying to stay out of trouble and do what I need to do for my interests. And I just naturally don't want to break the rules. It's not because I'm trying to maintain clear conduct exactly. It's just something that I don't like doing. It maintains order and keeps everything flowing the way it's supposed to.
Have you ever been discharged from a program since you've been participating?
Not that I can remember.
And the world is much different than it was when you were 14 years old. Obviously, you are an adult, 39 years old. Are there any programs that you believe the Department of Corrections could offer you to help you be successful in the event that you are given an opportunity of parole?
Well, the reentry coordinators help a lot of people with situations like that. I'm not aware of any program specifically that would benefit someone in that situation, but, you know, after being in so long, having to acclimate to the world outside of prison, I'm not aware of any program that would benefit that, not that I'm aware of.
All right. So, and again, you have been incarcerated for 25 years, so the world is much different. What do you think it's going to take for you to be successful on the outside?
Family support and trust. I have to trust people that they have my best interests in mind when they're helping me, which is something I'm able to do now. And it's just, it's one of those things that would take time, from what I understand.
This kind of circles us back around to your mental health. And I know you specifically stated that you don't pay attention because you've had several different diagnoses over the year. Am I recalling that correctly?
Well, I don't pay attention to the diagnoses exactly. I pay attention to my mental health, but not the exact label for what that is.
Do you pay attention to the treatment options?
Yes.
And what are those treatment options?
I see a psychologist and a psychiatrist. I see the psychiatrist every 3 months, and I see the psychologist every 3 months when there's one on staff. There's been periods of time throughout the years where they've not had one that was able to do regular therapy for people. But I talk to them as I'm allowed to, and I take advantage of all the help they offer me.
Are you on medications currently?
Yes, ma'am.
And do you recall how many meds you take?
I take 3 psych meds and 1 med for blood pressure that's from the medical doctor.
Will you have access to those psych meds? You're given the opportunity of parole?
Yes. Yes, they when you get out, they give you so many days supply of medicine. So it would enable me the chance to see a provider of some sort, psychiatrist or nurse practitioner or someone that is able to write the prescription. And I would see them regularly too.
Is it your intent to continue your psychiatric and medications and treatment if you are given the opportunity of parole?
Oh, definitely. I've followed with that ever since I started the medicine and seeing psychologists. I followed through with that over the years the whole time. I find that to be very beneficial.
Have any of those voices that you hear ever told you not to take your meds?
No.
All right, sir, at this time we are going to discuss the reason that brings you before us today, and that is your crimes of murder, criminal attempted murder, that's 3 counts of the murder, 5 counts of criminal attempted murder, and burglary first degree. Tell me about those crimes.
Well, the burglary happened several days before the shooting happened. And the burglary was, I think it was a Thursday, and I went into a neighbor's garage and took some guns and some bullets and put them in a bag and carried them back to the house.
Why did you do that?
I didn't know exactly at the time what was going to happen, but I mean, I was hearing in my head to do certain things, but I should have known, you know, anytime you steal guns is wrong. And anytime you do anything with them, but, you know, when you're 14, anything you do with a gun is not good. I wouldn't think so. And I should have known that it was going to lead to something terrible. I should have known that at the time.
So you took those guns on a Thursday?
Yes.
Prior to December the 1st?
Yes.
All right. Keep going.
The shooting happened Monday, December 1st. And I had the guns and I took them into the school, and people were asking me what it was because they were wrapped in a blanket. And I told them it was an English project. But everyone seemed to accept that as an answer. So I got to the lobby and I set them down, the guns, and I took off my backpack that had a gun and ammunition in it. And I just kind of stood around for a while, just kind of standing there. And then I went and got the gun out of the backpack and I held it in front of me. And I don't remember firing the gun or how many times I fired it. But the next thing I remember is people laying on the ground, and there was another student that came from behind like a brick column, and he asked me what I was doing. I don't remember what the verbal exchange was, but he was approaching me as we were talking, and I seem to remember telling him to kill me. I'm not sure if that's the exact words, but the principal came out and got me and took me back to the offices, and they put me in the room with, I don't know who he was a staff member that worked there. And he was asking me, he asked me some questions. I don't remember exactly what they were, but they just seemed odd to me at the time. They just seemed kind of random. And I waited for the police to show up.
Mr. Parnell, who is Nicole?
She was a friend. She's one of my victims that had been killed.
Can you repeat that?
She was one of my friends, and she's dead now. I killed her.
Who was Holland?
He lived around the corner from me. I would now, looking back, I would consider him a friend. He's also one of my victims.
Missy?
She was, I think, a grade ahead of me, and I knew her pretty well too. She's one of my victims.
Casey?
She's one of my victims. We were in band together, and she offered me a seat next to her on the bus. I'll never forget it. Nobody would let me sit with her, and she let me sit. We were all going on a trip, and she said, "You can sit here." I'll never forget that.
Jessica?
She's one of my victims. She was older than me by 3 or 4 years, I think. She was older, but she was also in the band, and she was always a positive leader in the band. She was always helping the younger people out.
Kelly?
She was one of my victims as well. She was friends with Melissa Jenkins, one of my other victims, and they were hanging out together a lot.
Jessica?
She was one of my victims, yeah.
Is there any particular reason that you shot these people?
Nothing. No, it's not justified. Not justified at all. There's no excuse for it at all. And the reason it happened, it's like a combination of factors in my life. And when I look at it now, it was because I was a coward.
Tell me what those factors are that you're referring to.
My mental health at the time, my age, and my maturity level wasn't.
Tell me what your age had to do with that.
I was 14 at the time, and I had not experienced anything in life, really. I didn't know exactly the effect of what I would do eventually. I didn't know what that would actually mean. I didn't know the hurt and the pain it would cause people. I was ignorant to that.
So Mr. Carneal, I am assuming, and you could correct me if I'm wrong, that you are an intelligent being at 39, and if I had to guess, also at the age of 14. Is that correct?
I don't know about intelligent. I function, yes.
Okay, so we'll go with functioning. Are you telling the board today that at 14 years old, you did not know if you killed several people, you didn't know that it would cause harm or hurt? Is that what you're telling us today?
I didn't realize the extent of the emotional pain it would cause people. It didn't seem like, it didn't seem as real to me then as it does now, because now I realize I'm able to see it and I know the terrible.
Carneal, we're talking specifically about when you were 14.
Right.
Are you telling us that you did not know right from wrong at 14?
No, I'm not saying that.
Okay. So the answer would be yes, I did know right from wrong. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Did you know that if you walked in a school and fired a handgun at multiple people and killed them, that that was wrong?
Yes.
Thank you. All right. Your PSI, your official record, tells us that initially, one of the comments that you stated, and give me just a moment so I can quote it accurately. You had taken those weapons to school several days before the incident. Is that correct?
No. With a handgun, I had taken to school several days before the incident, not all the weapons.
Hey, why did you do that?
I was showing it off to people. I thought it was interesting, and I thought it was just something that people thought would be cool to show off.
And did people think that was cool?
I don't know.
Did you plan these events?
And to some degree, yes.
Tell me about that.
It had been a long time thing where I had thought about what it would be like to be in the school and just nobody would be there. It would just run around, and I don't know. I thought about what it'd be like being in the mall with nobody else there and situations like that. And it just kind of developed into the idea of what it would be like if people were not there because of something I did. I don't know exactly. I didn't think exactly about like shooting people and killing them. It was just something, originally, it was just something that I thought I would do something and everybody would leave the school and I would just run around.
So do you think that those thoughts were a result of a 14-year-old mischievous mind, or were these thoughts as a result of your mental health?
I think it started out as a mischievous mind and it developed into more than that, something a lot worse than that.
All right. And if we fast forward from what you just said back to today, when we speak of your mental health and your prognosis is listed as poor and further states, and I will repeat, that though you have been receiving mental health services for many years, you still experience paranoid thoughts with violent visual imagery. So how could the board be certain that when you have these thoughts with the violent imagery that you state you still have, how can we be certain that you will not act on those?
I haven't acted on them in years, you know, decades, and that's a start. That's just a start. I would hope that you, the parole board, could see that I plan on continuing that and doing something positive in the long run with my life.
Mr. Carneal, do you believe you deserve an opportunity of parole today?
I don't know that, honestly. I mean, it depends on when you ask me. Sometimes I think, you know, that I would just deserve to be killed. You know, sometimes I think that, honestly. And then other times I think that due to the fact that I could do some good for a lot of people, maybe, that it would be beneficial if I were released someday.
Well, and I've heard you mention that you could do some good for people. I think you said that a couple of times today. Can you expound on that?
Well, I mean, it doesn't have to be something grand, you know. Just every little thing you do affects a person, and it could be something positive, just like, you know, listening to somebody when they have a problem, or helping them carry something, or it could be, you know, it starts out small on a daily basis. And I think I can build upon that. And I would like to do something in the future that would contribute to society as a whole.
All right, sir, I believe those are all the questions that I have for you at this time. I'll see if my colleague, Mr. Larry Brock, has any questions or comments for you.
Thank you, Ms. Jones. Mr. Carneal, I do have a few questions, and I'll try to make sure I don't cover any of the territory that Ms. Jones covered. But I'd like to ask you a few more questions about the actual crimes that were committed and what led up to it. And the first thing I'd like to know is, what kind of relationship did you have with your parents and sister when this, about the time all this happened?
They never did anything to me to make me feel bad. I grew up in a very good home. You know, Dad was just regular hours. We ate dinner together. It was a good home life. But towards closer to the commission of the crime, things kind of deteriorated with me in the way I trusted my parents and my sister, and the way I thought something would happen to them. And I would say at the time of the crime, they weren't aware that I was having any difficulties at all, I don't think. But I look back on it now, and I think they did everything they could. They were loving and supportive of me in every way they could be, even my parents and my sister.
So any issues you had were based on your behavior? I mean, they were positive in your life, your parents and your sister.
Yes, sir, definitely.
All right. Now, you talked a little bit about the guns that you had, that you brought into the school, and, you know, the handgun that was in the backpack, and some long guns that were wrapped in a blanket or sheet or something, correct?
Yes, sir.
So it leads me to the question of, you had a handgun in your backpack that you used. What was the purpose of the other firearms?
I took them simply because I had them. It wasn't, I've heard over the past years, people think that there was other students or other people involved in the crime. There was not. That's not why there were other guns. I just took them because I had them.
Well, didn't you tell the authorities at some point when they talked to you after all this happened that you and some others had a plan to take over the school?
I believe I did say that, yes, sir.
Well, what can you tell us about that?
I was being questioned by the police several times over different days, and they kept asking questions about other people possibly being involved in it. And I felt like, I thought the police were trying to help me and that they were actually my friends, just the way they were behaving towards me. And I told them that because I thought that's what they wanted to hear. I thought that that's what they wanted to hear, that it wasn't true at all.
Well, I think, you know, if you brought other guns into the school, I mean, it could lead to maybe the suspicion that others were going to be involved and opted not to participate. So I can see why the police may have reached that, you know, or had that question.
Oh, I understand. I understand the question completely. Yes, sir.
But you're saying that, well, let me ask you this then. Did anyone in particular, well, let me back up. So you never, are you saying you never had any discussions with any of your friends about anything to do with taking over the school or shooting or anything?
No, sir.
No one knew what was going to happen?
No, sir.
Had you ever used firearms before, shot firearms, target practice, any of that?
I did it. Camp, summer camp, I went 4-H camp, and they had some kind of little rifles we did target practice with. And there was after I stole the guns, I had taken some of them to a friend's house, and we went in his backyard, and I shot, so there's like a ball in the back in the backyard, and we shot at that.
So you're 14 years old. I mean, how did you learn to operate these firearms? I mean, it's just not something that's innate. You don't know that naturally. How did you learn to operate the firearms?
I guess TV. I don't know exactly. I mean, it was just one of those. I mean, I just looked at it and kind of figured it out. I mean, you know, they almost any movie you watch almost anymore, there's a gun in it. That was one of the things that I had seen.
So I think you said you shot some with a friend. Did you shoot at anything in particular? What kind, any kind of targets?
No, just there was a ball in the backyard that he had been sitting in his backyard, and we just shot at it.
So, Mr. Carnell, who were your intended targets when you started this shooting?
There were no intended targets. I mean, when I was looking around, when I was standing there, I didn't know specifically who was there. I just knew there was people standing there. I didn't know who it was.
So you were familiar with the prayer group, were you not?
I was familiar that they met there in the mornings, yes, sir. I didn't know exactly when it was that it took place, and they were not targeted at all. That was not what was going on.
So don't you think it seems kind of odd that the vast majority of the ones injured or killed were in that group?
I mean, I can see how people would think that I was targeting them just the way the events happened, but that's not what was going on.
The shotguns you brought in, where did they come from?
Those came from my dad's closet. He had them up on a shelf in some kind of container thing, and I had took those.
Were the other guns loaded that you brought in?
Yes, sir, I believe so.
So on the day this happened, how long were you in the lobby before the shooting started?
I had been standing there. I'm not sure about the time, maybe. I would guess 10 minutes, maybe. I was just kind of standing around.
Were you talking to your friends?
I believe so, yes. Yes, there were other people there that I normally talk to in the mornings. They were there. I'm pretty sure I was talking to them.
So you mentioned to Ms. Jones, I think, particularly about the bus, that there apparently you had some issues with some kids, but it would be fair to say, wouldn't it, that you had friends at the school?
I see that now. Yes, I do. I do. Yes, sir.
I mean, didn't you have a group of friends that you talked to and that you hung around with?
At the time, I didn't see that, but now that I look back, I realize that there were a lot of people that supported me and helped me and were friends with me that I took for granted, and I didn't realize that because of my perception of how I was being treated.
Just bear with me a second, Mr. Carney. I'm just looking through some information here. Mr. Carnell, how old were you when you knew that you couldn't kill someone?
Knew that I couldn't, like.
You could not? How old were you when you knew you couldn't kill someone?
Oh, did I know that it was wrong?
Well, I think there's a point in time that most of us know that it's wrong to kill someone. I'm asking you know, at what point in your life did you figure that out?
Oh, young? I don't know exactly, very young.
So you knew that was wrong before you went into the school, did you not?
Yes, sir.
Good, thank you. What do you think the community perception of you is, Mr. Carnell?
That I'm a monster. I believe that's what people think of me.
Can you blame them for that?
No, I understand that sentiment. Yes, sir, I understand why people would think that.
Do you Do you have any sense of the damage you've caused to these families that were involved and how this affects their life, and how it's affected their life since this shooting occurred?
I met with Melissa Jenkins in the past, and she explained a lot of that to me, and it's something that I can't even imagine the way that I have made these, all these people, not just the victims and the victims' family and friends, but also the community, the destruction I've caused in their life.
Do you understand this is something that never goes away for them?
Yes, sir, I understand that.
So you're in prison, but in a lot of ways, they're in a prison of their own. You ever think of that?
Yes, sir, I think of that often.
Mr. Carnell, have you ever provided items to anyone to put online for sale?
No one that I knew they were going to do it. I occasionally get letters from people that I don't know, and I respond to it. And people have different motivations for writing. And apparently, I learned later on after I failed to this, that people were writing me and lying about everything. Everything they told me was a lie. And then when I would write them, they were selling the letters and the envelopes. And there was even someone that wrote me from Paducah that told me their son was being bullied and they wanted advice on what to tell their son. And I wrote back a letter trying to help them with the situation. And I found out that was sold. I mean, I don't know. I've never benefited from it. I've never profited from it. I don't, these dealers who do this stuff, I guess they're called, I don't approve of that because it's all, they lie about it.
So if that happened, you say it was because you were misled by?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, Mr. Carnell, I think some would probably argue that your actions, what you did that day, set the stage for, you know, all the school shootings that have followed in the modern era. What's your thought on that?
Even today, when these things happen, I feel responsible for them on some level. When I was initially arrested, for about a year after that, I wasn't in a situation where I had media access. So I didn't realize a lot of this stuff was going on. And then in 99, when I was sent to the Northern Kentucky Youth Development Center, there was a little bit more newspaper and magazine access. And that's when Columbine happened. And that really, I really feel responsible for that. That's when I became suicidal, when I attempted to hurt myself and I had to be sent to a hospital because of that.
Mr. Carnell, if someone had gunned down your parents and your sister like you did to these folks, what would you want the parole board to do?
I don't know. Honestly, I don't know. I mean, it depends on what they had done with their lives, honestly. You know, I mean, some people come to prison and they continue that pattern of behavior. And that's not somebody that I would want to release, but somebody that did that and showed that they could do something different and positive with their life, I might advocate for that. I don't know, honestly, I don't know.
And you identified a number of the folks in the prayer group as your friends, right?
Yes, sir.
But yet, you shot them. They witnessed, some of them witnessed you shooting them.
Yes, sir.
So, you haven't, I mean, well, let me back that up and ask you this. I mean, I think you said there were some people didn't treat you very well.
I perceived it that way. I don't know, looking back on it, I don't think it was really happening the way I perceived it to be.
Okay, but, well, you thought some people were perhaps not treating you very well. That was your perception, but you also said the people in this prayer group, they were friends of yours.
Yes, sir.
So, and any of those people treated you bad in your perception?
No, not at all.
So, why would you target your friends as opposed to someone maybe that you had the perception that treated you poorly?
I wasn't targeting anybody. No one was targeted. It was just a crowd of people that was there, and I was there. It was in the lobby. No one was targeted.
Was it timed in a certain way?
No, it was just that morning, you know, I mean, first thing in the morning. That's why it happened then, I guess, yeah.
Because the record seems to indicate that the shooting started right as the prayer group was ending, right as they offered an amen at the end of their session they had.
I've heard that through the media before, but I don't know if that's correct or not. I don't know.
So that didn't play any role in what you did?
No, sir.
All right, Mr. Cornell, I believe that's all the questions I have. Thank you.
Mr. Cornell, I just have a couple more questions for you. We return to thinking of your victims. How many victims did you have that day?
Eight.
Can you name them?
Casey, Nicole, Jessica, Craig, Holland, Melissa, I called her Missy, Kelly, and Shelly.
Okay. And of those eight, I believe when I called them off earlier, I may have inadvertently left off Craig.
Yeah.
Of those eight, was Craig or any of the others, or how many of the others were your friends?
Well, Nicole was a very good friend. I consider her a very good friend. You know, looking back on things, I do. And some of them I knew more than others. The ones that were in high, you know, higher grades above me, I didn't know as well, but I still knew them. I mean, it's a small school, and a lot of these people were in band with me. And I knew all of them. Yes, I'd been to several of them's birthday parties. You know, I have memories with different ones at different times, and none of them do I have any negative memories with. I knew them. The ball.
Okay, so sitting there 25 years later, and you're solely thinking of your victims, specifically the ones that you are calling your close friends, how does that make you feel that you took the life or injured those eight, specifically those that are your friends?
It makes me feel terrible that I hurt anybody. I mean, my friends or not my friends or anybody, you know, I mean, makes me feel terrible that I did that to anybody at all.
Mr. Carneal, I will stand corrected when I tell you, I know you answered and said you had 8 victims. You have 8 people that you, 3 that you killed and 4 that you injured, or 5. But you actually have victimized an entire school.
A whole community.
Students, teachers, bus drivers, counselors, janitors, with your actions that day.
Yes, ma'am.
I don't believe that you offered much of a reason behind it that would support your thoughts on that day and 25 years later. Before we conclude this portion of the hearing, do you believe that you had adequate opportunity today to express your desire for parole?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Is there anything else that you wish to share with the board before Mr. Brock and myself go off camera to deliberate?
I would like to say to you and to the victims and the victims' friends and families and the whole community that I'm sorry for what I did. I know it's not going to change anything. It's not going to make anything better, but I want them to know that I am sorry for what I did.
All right, sir, if you'll just keep your seat, Mr. Brock and myself will go off camera for just a moment to deliberate, and we'll be back with you.